Ladies and gentlemen, the program will begin momentarily. As a courtesy to the presenters and audience, please turn off your mobile devices at this time. Thank you.
There we go. First words. Hi, Tamomi. Okay, well, I think we're ready to get started here. Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome. My name is Art Dahm, and I'm a developer relations engineer at LGE Silicon Valley Lab. Here today to talk about Enyo and creating cross-platform apps for Tizen with Enyo. So what is Enyo? Enyo is a cross-platform a framework for building native quality cross-platform HTML5 apps. basically, what that means is that with Enyo, you write once and use it in the same framework to develop apps across multiple platforms, the web, desktop, and mobile. So Enyo is a truly cross-platform, optimized for mobile and desktop. It was built with mobile in mind and designed to scale well across a variety of form factors. It's small, the core is about 30K when it's compressed, and it's specially designed for speed and responsiveness on all platforms. Enyo is modular and designed to be extended by the user, by the developer community. Its core can be expanded with modules, UI widgets, and more. Enyo's elegant object model makes it simple to build and maintain even the most complex apps. You can use the Enyo encapsulation model to divide and conquer large projects. Because Enyo is modular, all the pieces are reusable. Enyo code can be reused within one project, across your projects, and even by other Enyo developers. Enyo is completely free. It's been released under the Apache 2.0 license, and it's available on GitHub. Okay, and why would you use Enyo? By using Enyo, you only have to write an application once and it will run across all platforms and devices. With Enyo, you can create HTML5 apps with polish and performance that stand up to any native apps with a professional UI widget set. Here are the platforms that we support with Enyo. You have all the major browsers. You have Chrome, Firefox, IE, Opera, Safari, and then most of the mobile devices, iOS, Android, WebOS, Tizen, Windows 8, Windows Phone 8, BlackBerry. Basically anything with a modern WebKit browser will run well. So we have, where did Enyo come from? Basically, Enyo was born from WebOS. Most of you probably have heard of WebOS. It's the operating system used on the HP touchpad. And before touchpad was released, WebOS was running on smaller form factor devices like Palm Pre. And when it came time to scale to the bigger screen, we found that application framework we had at the time wasn't quite suited for the larger screens. So we needed something that would work across all screen sizes. We also saw there was a void in the market, so we created Enyo 1.0 to power all the on-device applications, including phone apps and over 1,200 catalog applications on the touchpad. When the HP stopped making hardware devices, we took Enyo and created a cross-platform version. We called that Enyo 2, and we're currently on version 2.2. So what does Enyo look like? Basically, you have Enyo libraries and tools for creating your apps. you have the Enyo core, which gives you the objects that you use to create your app, encapsulation, inheritance, ownership hierarchy, and what we call kinds, which are sort of a class and components. We provide event routing through depatcher and signals. We have service model for async and AJAX components. We also wrap the basic HTML components for a base UI. And then finally, we have a package loader, which we call Enyo which is package.js, which basically has all your JavaScript files that pulls in as needed. We also have Aries, which is a GUI developer toolkit, but it's currently in development, but you can go to the GitHub since everything in Enyo is completely free and open, and you can see where we are at any time. Hopefully we'll have that ready for you guys soon. We have the layout library, which all the libraries are optional. Basically, you need the Enyo core, but you can bring in whatever libraries you need. So the first one we have is the layout library, which gives you fittable rows and columns, panels, lists, and a tree view. And then we have our Onyx library, which is UI controls, buttons, inputs, pop-ups, headers, and a bunch of other things. The Enyo core, like as I said, is the objects. It gives you event routing, services, models. This is duplicating for some reason. Here we go. Here's the object-oriented features. Basically, Enyo has an object-based system called kinds. Kinds are objects and classes. Enyo kind is a factory for creating the kinds, and basically you use that to create your app and objects within objects within objects, basically. Enyo's object model makes it testing easier because code is broken up into smaller maintainable pieces. Here we go. Here's the layout library. Basically, it provides responsive design, so it adjusts, the layout will adjust itself depending on the size of the screen, and also assists with lists, which can be different across different devices, and we make that easy for you. We also help out with mobile performance and trees. Let's see if I can go over to the sampler so you get an idea of what Enyo looks like when it's on a device or in the browser. And so switch my view here. Here we go. So this is enyojs.com where you can find the documentation, the API, the community, a bunch of other stuff. Let's go to the sampler, which is on enyojs.com/sampler. Here you can see, basically it's going to show you all the components of Enyo all in one app. So right now it's running in the browser, but you can package this up and put it onto a device, or you can look at it on a device screen. If you have one on, you can just go to enyojs.com/sampler and follow along. So here's the core. We have, you can query the platform. Use Ajax, so you have Ajax, JSONP, web service components. Scroller, which is basic scroller. Because I'm on a PC, it knows to use scroll bars. If I was on a tablet or phone or something, it would hide the scroll bars and I'd just use the touch interface. The Enyo.js takes care of that for you. We have repeaters, which basically repeating lists. And then gestures, which won't do much good on a PC. So if we go back and show you the Onyx library, which we created a whole full set of widgets for you to use in your apps, basically everything from toolbars with buttons and content, basic buttons, colored group buttons, inputs, progress bars, which are colorful, sliders, drawers, menus, pickers, bunch of other things. And then layout, which is where you basically you're showing off the different types of layouts for your apps. So you can use panels, rangers, which we going through the different panels in your app, for instance, let's say. So that's basically the sampler. And like I said, you can download it, you can play with it, it's on GitHub. So now if I go back to my slides here. So we had the layout library, Onyx library, and then Tizen to WebOS, because Enyo began life in WebOS, they share a lot of they both share common use of the web standards. So here's Open WebOS, a diagram of Open WebOS. You can see that you have the Linux kernel, and then above that you have HTML, JavaScript, CSS, and on top of that sits Enyo, and then on top of that sits your application. And if you look at like a Tizen architecture, for instance, you have a similar thing with the Linux kernel, the web framework, and then your web app on top of that. So then I was actually, everyone got your little Tizen for Dummies book. I was looking through it the other day and I saw on page, I think it's 97 or something like that, there's a chart, and I found this chart here. And if you look at WebOS and Tizen, you can see how a WebOS app and a Tizen app are very similar in structure-wise. They both have icons, index HTML, and then you can have JavaScript, CSS images. In WebOS, you have appinfo.json, which basically describes the information for the app needs to run on the device, where the icons are, where the index HTML is, and other information, version number, whatever. In Tizen, you have config.xml, which does a similar thing. So if you take, if you're a WebOS developer or if you've written an Enyo app, you can basically just take the same app, add the Tizen config.xml, and you're pretty much good to go. Basically, in WebOS, you're doing an IPK, and Tizen, you're doing a WGT, which is basically a zip renamed. So then we have packaging apps with phone gaps. So if you're not using an operating system like WebOS or Tizen that supports web standards for your apps, web standards apps as first-class citizens, you might be using Java or something else to create your apps. You need something to create, to make your JavaScript app work on those platforms. What we suggest doing with those apps is to wrap them up a phone gap. So you might as well hear it called Cordova. Cordova is the open source engine that powers phone gap. And so Enyo works very well with phone gap. We're not associated with phone gap, but we work closely with them. So basically you take your JavaScript app written with Enyo and you package it up. And PhoneGap will provide several things for you. First, it gives you a common API that you can use to access your device's resources. So for the camera and all that, you can use the PhoneGap API for iOS, Android, and the other platforms it supports. And plus, it provides a wrapper to turn your JavaScript app into an actual native app. Basically, it uses a web view and renders your JavaScript into a full screen web view. So PhoneGap has the main part of PhoneGap is basically files you download from off PhoneGap.com, and you use that locally. Or you can use PhoneGap build, which is actually a lot easier for if you're just starting out with PhoneGap. I think I have, if I go to the browser here, show you a little bit of what that looks like. There it is. So basically, this is like my little play app that I play around with when I need to experiment. It's called Spin for it. So basically, you can upload your code. You can either zip it up, all your files into one zip, and upload it to PhoneGap build, build.phonegap.com, and it will do all this on the server side, on their servers, and spit out iOS, Android, Windows Phone, BlackBerry, WebOS, and so on. And so it's a very simple way to get up and running using a cross-platform app. So you write your Enyo app, zip it up, and upload it. Or if you have your app on GitHub, you can just point this to GitHub, and it'll do it there. And you're up and running. So PhoneGap build is a fairly easy way to get up and running. And so we also have Bootplate, which we created. It's it's a starter project available on GitHub. It's a hello world sort of thing, but it also provides a way of packaging your app. It'll minify your app. You run a script, and it'll take your app and minify it and make it ready for deployment. And so it's a great way to get up and running. And so our roadmap for Enyo basically is we're working on data binding, which is data storage, MVC, and hopefully that'll be in next release or soon after. Next release will be 2.3, which hopefully is just around the corner. Hopefully we're going to be working on next generation lists and grids, new UI libraries, and then we're going to have app templates, more docs, data grids, charts, And then I think we also have a community on enyojs.com where people have, Enyo is community supported, and in addition to the libraries we provide, the Enyo community also has contributed back with their own components, which are available in the community gallery at enyojs.com. And so we hope you'll get involved, you'll try it out, you'll give us your feedback, and support your fellow developers. Give feedback, build and share your own add-ons, and contribute code back to the project on GitHub. So let me just quickly go through some code. It's basically the introduction to Enyo, so I'll just go through some live stuff now and show you how easy it is to use Enyo. So basically, you saw the Tizen for Dummies book and the chart. There's also a couple of pages in here where they actually mention Enyo, and in two pages they show you how to get up and running. So if you had a chance, look through that. And so it just shows you the two pages, they show you how to write an Enyo app. And then we also have from O'Reilly, and it's also available on, from Amazon, Enyo Up and Running, written by our own Roy Sutton. So that's a nice book to get you up and running with Enyo. It's a quick read. So if we go back to the browser. The nice thing about Enyo, because it's written with JavaScript, we can bring it up in JS Fiddle and play around with it, and it's very easy. Just take some samples. These are actually samples from Roy's book, and so he has the URLs in the book, and I basically go into them and bring them up, and basically he has what's basically a streetlight sample. So basically he starts out with a single light and goes on to create a red, green, and yellow streetlight, basically, showing how to use the Enyo kinds. So right now, basically, in the JS Fiddle, you have the HTML panel, you have the JavaScript panel, and you have the CSS panel, and then when you click Run, it'll go through your code and show it off in this results panel here. So what we have here is an Enyo kind, and it has a name of light, and then we have some CSS styles for it. And it's basically a matter of once we have the Enyo library up and running, we just create a new light and render into the document body. So with Enyo, you're not really playing with the HTML much because you basically start with your code, which is this here, and it's going to render into the DOM, into the document body for you. So this is the very basic sample where it's just showing you a single kind, and then if you want to expand upon that, we can take the light, and this is basically showing you a published property. So basically you set the color, and then we have the functions that are in here. We create, which will change, will call any inherited creates from the base kind. And we also have a color change property, which will apply the CSS style depending on when the published property changes. Because the property is published, and you will create a get and a set function for you. So you can call, this is, the property is called color, so when you call, when you substantiate this object, you can call setColor to change the color, or you can call getColor to get the color, and you will automatically create these functions for you. So here, so if I change the color, for instance here, we are creating a new light, and we're telling it that we want it to have the color green, and originally in our kind, we had it set to yellow. If I want to change it to blue, I can run it now. It should change to blue. So basically, this is just setting, showing you how to use published properties within your code. If we want to play around with it a little more, actually, if we go, let's go back to the original one. So let's experiment a little bit here. We can say, okay, here we have the light kind. Let's add an app and put the light into the app. So if I can spell, it would help. So now I have the app kind. I'm going to put kinds inside it now. So I'm going to do that. Then I'm going to put in kind we'll see how it goes. Now we close the parentheses. Ah, come on. I'm used to using a full-size keyboard. Then we close the kind. Okay, so now we have the app, which will have two lights inside it. We have to go up to the HTML, change this to a new app. Hopefully, if I don't have any typos in here, we'll see two lights. And we don't, because there's a typo somewhere. Thank you. Run. Yay. Okay, so basically, what we're doing is showing how you can use components within components. So basically, this is an app that has two components in it. If I was writing a larger app, I'd take the light kind, which would have more stuff in it, and put it in its own JS file, then use Enyo depends to bring it into my app. And I create different JavaScript files for each of the different components, and that way I can just, if I have different apps that need the same component, I can just pull them all in, and that's how I would use the encapsulation and components to bring them in. So then if I want to inherit, let's see if I can screw things up even more. So we want to inherit from light, so we'll create a new kind. So we're going to inherit from the light. We'll call this highlight. Okay. And then we'll put inside it some components. Let's quickly do this. Okay, so we have a new kind here. It's inheriting from light. We're calling it highlight. So now let's put, if I spell components right, could help too. Content high. Excuse me? Components. Oh, no. Components. Should call them cos or something easy. Okay, that should work. Let's try it. Let's see what happens. Okay, so we highlight, and the highlight's in the corner, so we can play around with that a little bit. We can add some CSS to it. We can say styles colon. Let's add some padding to it. We'll ignore that for now. One thing we can do, we can instead of having the styles within the code itself, if we want to put it in the CSS, we can just copy it and do CSS class light. And then we can go down here and change this to classes colon light. And it should still work, because now we're pulling the CSS from the actual CSS file instead of having it inside the code, so we have separation of concerns, which isn't always nice. And so basically that's encapsulation and inheritance. Let's see what else Roy had in his book here. So we have this, which I went over, and then here's more inheritance, basically changing the different colors in the traffic light component he has created here. And then what else is interesting in here? Basically, we have the published color. Basically, on when the component is created, it calls the color change function, which applies the style of the color. The color change function is interesting because when you publish a property, it creates the getter and the setter. So when you call set whatever the name of the property is, so in this case set color, it calls it. In addition to creating the set color, it will also call any color change function that you have provided for the app. So in this case, it's sort of like a side effect, in which case when you're setting the color of the property, the side effect that you also want is for the color of the HTML5 element to change also. So in Enyo, if you don't tell it what kind of element you want, it's going to default to a div. So in this case, it's basically a div with a rounded border, which is how we got these things to show. And then on this one, we have, we're adding some events. So basically, it's called powered lights because if you click on a light, it will dim them or turn them back on. So basically, we're publishing color, and then we're in the handlers, here we go. On tap event, we're going to call the tap function. So here we have tapped this set powered. So that's calling the set function for the powered property. And it's basically just not toggling it back and forth. And then on the powered change, it goes through and applies the style of dimming it by saying the opacity. And so basically you have the three different kinds of lights which have been had their color property changed to red, yellow, and green. So there's that. Basically now, just to quickly show you how to get, so I'm fairly new to Tizen, and I wanted to see how easy it was to get my Enyo app that I had already written into Tizen. How easy is that? So I went into the Tizen IDE. My mouse disappeared on me. There it is. Keep losing my mouse. Here it is. Okay, so basically, what I did was created a new Tizen web project. I chose the basic. So, like I said, WebOS or Enyo apps are HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. So basically, it should be pretty easy to get it in there. So let's bring over the sampler. I'll call it sampler TDC. Finish. Okay, so now I have this sampler TDC project. So it gives me the basic. I don't need all this stuff, so I'm just going to delete it all, except for I'm going to keep the config.xml because it has all the Tizen specific stuff in it. Come on, unselect. There we go. And they're all gone now. The only thing we have left in the project is config.xml. So now I'm going to import my project from file system. Sampler, where are you? There we are. I already deployed it using bootplate. So if I go to sampler, so now I just choosing the whole structure and then pulling it in. Now I should be able to just bring it up in the simulator. seconds to think about it. Oh, here it is on my screen. Bring it over. And so now we have the sampler that basically the basic Enyo sampler, which I showed you on the web page at enyojs.com/sampler. Here it is running in the simulator in Tizen. And basically all I did was pull in the files and give it a config.xml, and Tizen, it runs really well in Tizen, actually. We have it on an actual device in the vendor hall. I don't know if you had a chance to stop by and see it. It's actually pretty impressive how smooth everything runs. And so that's basically bringing an app into the Tizen. So I think pretty much, again. That's pretty much all I have. So hopefully you'll get involved. Here are some resources, enyojs.com. And like I said, you can find us on GitHub at github.com/enyojs. Or also on IRC. You can reach see us on Twitter. And we also have the book Enyo up and running. So if you all have any questions, I'm happy to answer them. Go ahead. There's a microphone right behind you. And try it again. No.
Uh-huh. Awesome. Thank you.
There we go.
So my experience has been that when you try to add DOM elements during the application startup time, that tends to slow things down. So and as I understand it, EnyoJS is all about adding all your DOM elements at startup time, right? So you basically start out with like HTML/HTML, and that's it,
right?
So how do you make it faster than, at least as fast as specifying all your DOM up front?
There is a small delay, but we have it, and in Enyo, it doesn't load all the DOM all at once. It does it on demand. So it only does it, only pulls in the DOM when it needs it. So it's, the delay is minified.
Okay, but if your application's front page is fairly complex, then you're still doing a lot of document.create element, right? For everything that you're trying to render. And that is slower than if you were to just grab a page. Is that not the case?
Yeah, but it's slower, but it's not noticeably slower. I don't know if you had a chance to play around with any of the apps that we have on the vendor floor, but you can see that they render very quickly. I mean, like I said, there's a little bit of delay when you start up the app, but I mean, it's not less than a second.
Okay, thanks.
Sure.
Hi. Thanks for the presentation, by the way.
Oh, thanks.
So my question is, how Enyo is better than existing solutions such as, for example, Twitter Bootstrap or Sencha?
Well, we have Sencha, which is not free and open source, number one.
Okay.
So that's the main advantage we have over Sencha. And so this is Apache 2.0 license. It's completely free.
But Twitter Bootstrap, for example, is also free.
Okay, well, we have the component model, which we enjoy, and also it's a different way of looking at creating your app, basically. So if you're more JavaScript centric, you might be more interested in Enyo, for instance, and we also have more of a component model and more behind the scenes as opposed to UI stuff.
Okay, and one following. You said that you're planning to make Enyo MVC style. How is it going? And when it will be available, in which version?
I believe it will be in 2.3, but don't quote me on that. And that's coming up soon. It's on GitHub. You can play with it now if you want. I mean, we have people in-house who have been writing apps using the MVC, but it's been a moving target, so to speak. So it's being worked on. It should be in the next version, hopefully. And it's on GitHub, so if you want to play around with it now.
Okay, because this could be like a big advantage over, for example, Twitter Bootstrap, which is not MVC, and MVC is
exactly
what we want.
Yeah. So
okay,
it's
thanks.
It's a major focus for us.
Thanks.
Hi.
I got a question on the example you showed when you fired it up on the IDE.
Yeah.
So did you import the project from a bootplate project or?
What I did was, right now I'm sort of a work in progress, my workflow basically, so I'm trying to figure out the best way to do it, because as far as I can tell on the Tizen IDE, you need to have the app that you're deploying in the root folder, and I'm trying to find some way, because when you're using bootplate, you're deploying your app and it's creating a folder called deploy, which has the minified, compacted code that you want to deploy as opposed to the code that you're working on. And so basically I had to pull in just that one folder into the Tizen IDE as opposed to the whole project. So basically what I do is, my favorite IDE is PHP Storm, just because I'm used to it. You can use whatever you want. I basically pull in the Bootstrap app. Basically I just download it as a zip from GitHub and then unzip it. And then I pull in my Enyo JS and plus any libraries I need, like the Onyx or the layout or whatever. So then I have my base project. It's basically when you run the bootplate app, it's basically hello world. So then you write your code and you go through it, and then when you deploy it, you do deploy.bat or deploy.sh, and it'll spit out the minified version. Then I brought it over into the Tizen IDE. I'm sorry. What was the question?
Essentially, you start off with a bootplate, and then you imported like only parts of the directory or something.
Yeah, basically. So when I'm working on my app, it's not minified. So I'm able to play around with it. And then when I'm ready to try it out, I basically do the deploy script, which will minify it. And then I need to bring just the minified directory itself, not the whole project, into the Tizen IDE.
Okay. So what other dependencies does Enyo require?
There are no other dependencies besides the Enyo JS library and whatever other libraries that I had on the slide, like the layout or the boots or the Onyx widgets. Basically, you can write your own widgets. You don't have to use Onyx.
Okay. So, would you suggest if you're going to use the Tizen IDE, just starting with the bootplate project?
Yeah, you can do that. I mean, it's up to you whether you want to minify it or not. I mean, on the device, it's not as important as if you're deploying it over the web, so maybe you might not want to use a minified project in your app, but if you want to save space, then you go the minified route.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, sorry, I have one more.
Sure.
So you said that there are no dependencies for Enyo, so what are you using for DOM manipulation? You are not using jQuery?
No, it's all in Enyo.
Okay, so you are using your own solution, yeah?
Correct.
Can it be used inside the application? So I can, I don't know, maybe manipulate the DOM using Enyo, like I can do it with jQuery, or is it deeply inside the jQuery the Enyo core that and I cannot use it above in my application?
It's, you have to kind of have like a different way of thinking when you're dealing with Enyo versus jQuery or something like that, because you're in Enyo you're dealing with components and controls, and in jQuery you're dealing with
DOM. I know.
So Enyo will take care of all the DOM for you when you call the Enyo functions, which create and destroy control.
Okay, but sometimes you need to move something, you need to add some animation,
right?
Besides the Enyo, I think. So is it possible to do it with this DOM manipulating solution of Enyo, or is it hidden so well under the hood that I cannot do that?
Well, it's hidden so well that you can use the way you you'd use Enyo the same way you'd use jQuery to do it. I mean, you're not asking jQuery how it does it, so you're not asking Enyo how it does it. You just call the functions and it does it. So also, if for some reason you wrote a jQuery project and you want to convert it to, for instance, I was working with somebody who had a jQuery project and they wanted to convert it to Enyo. So Enyo and jQuery played well together. So he was able to do the outer wrapper with the panels and all that in Enyo, and then inside the panel he had he pulled in some of his jQuery from his previous project, and it worked. Okay. So you can go
both ways.
Out. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, thanks.
Mm-hmm. We have any other questions? Well, thank you for coming, and I hope you enjoyed the show.